Welcome back to another installment in the Intelligent Idea Talkers podcast. I'm your host, Dee.
This is Juice.
Yes, 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 yes. What's going on, my brother?
Good, man. Good, man.
Like, how's the world been treating you these last couple days, man?
The week has been good. Like, my daughter's been around. Mm-hmm. Went to a wedding yesterday for my friend, Jasper and Ellen.
Okay, cool. So, how was that?
It was beautiful, man. We're a little bit late, you know? It was in the middle of the mountains. Mm-hmm. Out in Shenandoah. But,
You know black folks can't. We're not good with directions like that. Out in the mountains, I see. It's like the wilderness.
I don't know why they started on time. They know. That, look, we play capoeira, mm-hmm. You know, Brazilian time, you know, CB time. Look, I don't know why they started exactly at 2 o'clock. They should have pushed their drone back maybe another 15, 20 minutes.
Maybe they had the area,
minutes.
Like, rented or something like that.
Nah, so it was cool. It was cool.
But, you know, anytime you send in particular, black folks out to a wilderness setting, it's probably going to take us a little minute to get there, you know what I mean? Like, you might have found your way easier if they were going to, like, getting married in Arlington or something like that, you know what I mean?
Oh, definitely. There, dude, yeah. We drove up a mountain and passed, what was it, a tractor drove by me on the other side of the road.
Juice almost crashed because he couldn't believe it was a tractor.
I almost crashed.
Was that a tractor?
I was startled for a moment. I wasn't sure what it was.
Yeah, you know what I mean? Yeah, pulled off the road. And then when it was figure eight in the road and whatnot, it was a tire tracks.
Yeah, man, there was cows and turtles and crazy, and horses and badgers all over the place.
So he got married, huh? You ever see yourself getting married, man?
Wait, what?
Do you ever see yourself getting married?
Oh, I thought you said that if I ever seen somebody getting married. I was like, yesterday.
Yeah, yourself. Like, yeah, you know, while we're on the whole marriage topic, I mean, I don't know.
Sometimes I imagine. I'm scared of it. It's a cool, like,
It's a union prospect. Between two people, you know? I don't know.
Beautiful.
I look at it a little more seriously.
Yeah, it is. It's something serious. Like, it's something you shouldn't do frivolously.
No, of course not. It's not like, you know.
And it's a lot of work.
But it's almost easier nowadays for people to make the decision to have two people in particular, man and woman, to have a kid together than it is to get married. You know, I don't understand that logic. But, you know, if you have a kid and you're like, she tells you I'm pregnant, you say, okay, well, time to strap down, buckle in, get myself together, and get prepared for this kid. But as soon as she says, I want to get married. What? I got to go. I got to go record the Intelligent Idea Talkers podcast. I don't have time to talk about this right now.
You know? I got to go listen to it. So I'll be gone for a couple hours.
It's a little weird, man. But, you know, I'm glad your friend is happy, man. You know?
Yeah, it was a beautiful wedding. Like, it was really nice.
He can be with. And, you know, she found him the man for her. So, you know.
I ain't going to lie. Like, I got a little bit, you know.
A little misty eye,
you know what I'm saying? Like, when she was dancing with her dad, you know? Mm-hmm. Alright.
She looked beautiful.
I thought about my daughter. My daughter was sitting right next to me. I was like, oh, man. Come on, yo. You mean I gotta walk, I gotta dance with her in front of this chick? Like, in front of this dude? Like, wait a minute. He gonna take my daughter?
Mm-hmm.
Nah, son. But, you know, that's the way of life.
Yeah,
you know
it's a circle sometimes of life,
you just
man.
Gotta... You just gotta let it go, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I'm just saying, myself in particular, I'm scared of the subject of marriage, man. I don't know if I can ever, you know, jump over that hump and jump over that hill, man. It was hard enough for me to have my kid, you know? And like I said, man, getting married is just a dangerous prospect. It's a dangerous idea for me, you know? I'm glad your friend is happy. Tell him to watch it. Tell him to watch his back. I hope he gave you the key to that ball and chain and kept it on your key ring for him.
Yeah, actually, I got it.
Yeah, now you got a ball and chain around his ankle, man.
Yep.
Yeah, I'm only poking fun if he's listening to this podcast. So.
I'm definitely going to point to this podcast. Like, really?
Oh, man.
Hey, man, I got the key for you, bro.
Yeah. You know. Tell him, man, I got the nail file and everything like that, man. You need to cut that chain. That's all good, man. So, got a couple topics up for discussion tonight. And
first off,
I think we would be remiss if we didn't start this podcast off with the topic of Muhammad Ali. And
we lost another one, guys. Another great
Prince a couple weeks ago, and now Muhammad Ali, man.
That was unbelievable enough, but now Muhammad Ali.
I mean, he had a long, illustrious life and career. Died at 74 years old.
He was an activist, and he was a legend above all things. Like, he was one of the greatest fighters in boxing ever to.
We were talking about this at work today. Do you actually think that there's anybody who doesn't know who Muhammad Ali is? Like, if you say the name Muhammad Ali, it's that kind of... Okay, maybe
somebody
outside
in,
of
like,
America. But, like, if you take your suburban housewife in Massachusetts or whatever, you know, and you say the name Klay Thompson, like, people like us will say, yeah, he plays for the Warriors. They're playing in the NBA, you know, tonight. They're in the NBA Finals.
I don't know who Klay Thompson is.
If you tell her the name Muhammad Ali, automatically your brain snaps and it says, Muhammad Ali, of course I know who that is, you know?
That's the boxer. And
it's like he's world famous.
Float like a butterfly, sting like a bee. That guy.
And I think he's famous outside of the boxing ring as well, you know? In opposition to today's boxers, like, obviously Floyd Mayweather. I mean,
he's definitely popular and definitely a legend among the African American community. Probably first and foremost, like, white people loved him, of course, and as they should, you know. But for us, he was a model, like something to aspire to, and a model of strength and a model of integrity and somebody who stands with their convictions.
Mm-hmm.
So
definitely, I mean, if you're willing to
go
jail,
against the grain, yeah, like, you, that's who
I get drafted.
Yeah,
but I feel him. I mean, his I think he had a quote around that time was, you know, why should I go to another country to kill and maim other brown skinned people when brown skinned people in this country are getting beaten and killed and harassed every
right
single
here.
Day, you know, right here in this country. So, you know, and we have to realize that. The time that this was, you know, 1950s and 60s, and growing up in that time, you know, we were speaking before the podcast, like, it would be almost unfathomable today in 2016 to see somebody dragged out of their home at night and lynched, you know, but that those type of things were going on around this time. And, you know,
all the times up until that point as well. So it wasn't like it was
to be at the level and to take the stands that Muhammad Ali took at that time. You know, politically and in this country, it was radical, man. You know, he was, you know, you change your name at a time in the 60s when black people were already being persecuted, segregated. You change it from Cassius Klay to Muhammad Ali.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's radical, you know, by
that
those
is radical to change your name in any venue,
especially being who he was, the boxer
public
he was,
venue,
the fame
is...
he had, notoriety, you know.
Yeah.
He, you know, he will be missed. I mean, it was I'm pretty sure his life wasn't perfect. I mean, we're all humans. We all have our own vices. You know, I'm pretty sure he had his demons the same as every other man does. But,
Definitely.
You know, by all standards, he was a champion of the people, you know, especially at that time in this political climate of the country.
So... You know how, you know, not only the black community loved Muhammad Ali, but even the white community loved Muhammad Ali, was, I don't know what year, but he was written into a Superman comic. And they let Muhammad Ali knock out Superman.
He was larger than life.
Superman was the white pinnacle of fiction, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Fiction, of course. But the white pinnacle of fiction, to have...
Good-looking,
Muhammad Ali in a comic
guy,
book,
all powerful,
right?
Can do anything, and he got knocked out by a black guy.
By Supes. That's how you know he was so universal.
When did that comic come out?
I 70s. I should have got that info, but I didn't.
I'm pretty sure it was a long time ago, and even for them to take that stance in that comic was big. You know, that was huge.
Yeah. To be in it, but hey, man, like Muhammad Ali was definitely a legend, and. He stood out because it's always good to look at the defeats of history through a lens of like of that era.
Mm-hmm.
Like when you were there, like we see like movements now and you see people making changes now. You see history happening before you. And it's rarely that you realize what is happening as you're sitting there observing it.
Mm-hmm.
And in hindsight, in history, it's always a lot clearer. It's always a lot clearer when you look back and be like, oh, well, this is a point where this iconic person made this decision, which changed the course of history.
Mm-hmm.
When Cassius Clay changed his name to Muhammad Ali and started fighting, like, it's hard to imagine like what it was like when he started boxing at, I think, 13 or 14,
mm-hmm.
when he started boxing, that was a pivotal moment in history.
Of him changing
in history,
his name.
Not for only for black people and for white people, but for America.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that was a pivotal moment, and who would have ever thought, you know,
something so
light and simple
had so much of an impact on history. And, you know, yeah, man, I mean, you know, he'll be missed. And people always draw the connotation to him and his friendship with Malcolm X, and both of their political views and their beefs or qualms with the Nation of Islam around that time. They were both seen as radicals, man.
Yeah.
I don't know how Muhammad Ali felt about this particular subject when Malcolm X got shot or assassinated, killed. I'm sure he was scared.
They were friends. They were definitely friends. Despite whatever happened.
Like, I think they had a dissension because Malcolm X went against
Elijah
Muhammad and went against the Nation of Islam. And Muhammad Ali said anybody who opposed the Nation of Islam shouldn't be a member of it, should be killed. But, you know, their friendship, I'm pretty sure Muhammad Ali had to be fearful of his life during those times. And to still be as charismatic and such a larger-than-life figure as he was, man, I just couldn't imagine the kind of pressure on him from not only the boxing stage, but, you know, even the Nation of Islam, but just from black people as a whole. You know, he represented black people rising up and overcoming government oppression in a time when people actually needed that. They needed somebody to latch on to, like a Malcolm X, like a Muhammad Ali, like a Dr. Martin Luther King, and so many others who I don't even know anything about, you know. Yeah, man, it's just...
Definitely a fighter through and through.
He was a champion in the ring and as well as out. And that's why I said, I don't think there's anybody in the world who doesn't know the name Muhammad Ali. It's just, to me, you have to be living under a rock for the last 50 years to not know who he is, you know?
Yeah. I mean, you saw the movie with Will Smith. Not to switch topics, but that was one of the best,
depictions of a historical character.
It was Jamie Foxx as Ray, and it was Will Smith as Muhammad Ali. And you felt like that was the closest I've ever come living
Jamie Foxx
30 or 50 years.
Jamie Foxx was good in Ali, too. I forget the character he played. It was one of Cassius Clay, Muhammad Ali's friends in the movie. But
That's right.
But
yeah, like, as I think that was definitely necessary. Like, you know, the legend of Muhammad Ali is always known, and it was mostly spoken around in the boxing realms and in the, like, political activism realms. But, like, making him a current character again, that was one of the best things that could have done for Muhammad Ali, to have an actor like Will Smith play that role so well, and then go through those trials through the movie, through his training, and through his decisions, at least some of the primary ones. And going to Africa and how we felt when he was in Africa, and bringing that through, you know, through the film, like, that was definitely one of the best things.
You really felt it when you were watching the movie. Yeah,
it made him relevant again. Not that he was all ever really irrelevant, because we always knew who he was, but it made us, in a sense, the younger generation feel him again and be able to relate to him.
I think it's hard for people of our generation, and especially kids coming up nowadays, to really get a sense of what it was like back during this time of so much political uprising in this country, and when black people were, and not only black people, but people of all minority colors, but mainly black people, were persecuted and segregated and dehumanized. It's hard for us to really get a sense of what happened, because now things are just so much different, man. You have the internet, you have more freedoms. I mean, we're still discriminated against.
We are.
Just simply because of the color of your skin, but...
I like going online and having...
Yeah, I mean, you have so much access to information, and just the world as a whole is different. There's more acceptance of things. You know, homosexuality, you can be black, you know what I mean? You can be, you know, it's not just... it's not like you have to fit in any certain mold. But yeah, it's always hard for us to get a sense of that, man. And going back to Ali's movie, from what I've read, that was almost one of the best depictions of someone's life. You know, I'm pretty sure it was sensationalized in certain moments, as Hollywood tends to make it, but they follow the actual story of his life through that movie. And, you know, through Will Smith's acting, you really felt, like when he lost the title for not getting drafted, you felt that, you know what I mean? When he lost to, when he lost to Sonny Liston, you felt that, you know what I mean? It was crazy, man. I love that movie. That has to be See, I don't know. I like a lot of movies. I don't know if I would give that top 20, top 10. I have to say maybe top 20.
For non-science fiction action dramas, that's definitely in my top 10.
Now you're breaking it down into categories.
All right, yeah, we can break it down in that category. Non-science fiction movies, that was definitely one of the top ones.
Definitely, yeah. Man. But he will be missed, man. He had a lot of kids, too. The exact number. I think he had maybe 7 or 8 kids.
Layla Ali is definitely one of the...
She's probably most famous.
Most famous.
Yeah.
She was a fighter. And,
yeah, it's cool, man. It's, you know, but long live the champ, I always say. And, he was a champion of people, you know, champion in the ring and outside the ring. I mean, like I said, compare him to today's, how many people would go out on a limb and go against the grain and possibly destroy their relations with the public in a way that Muhammad Ali did, you know, by not getting drafted and by going to jail. He was in prison for that, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And no athlete today would take that kind of stance against the establishment, because then you're going to end up risking your own career. You know what I mean?
That's the thing.
They'll shun you from, if you say something against the establishment, as we're just talking about Klay Thompson, say Steph Curry come from the Golden State Warriors, or even LeBron James comes out and says, something politically based that he opposes. It's so much backlash that can happen nowadays.
That goes back to my topic, the point I was making earlier was like, you know, history. Like, you don't know when those decisions will change the course of history. But you're right. Like, a lot of the current people, athletes, actors,
people don't take that kind of risk.
They won't. And I don't know if I blame them, because the common man doesn't.
Understandably so. I mean, why would you want to risk everything you've worked so hard for? But
right,
Muhammad Ali did, and that's why he's a champion.
And that's why,
that's why he's a champion outside the ring. I mean, even compare him to boxers nowadays, Floyd Mayweather. There's no way you can compare him to Muhammad Ali. I mean, Floyd may be more successful financially, but when Floyd Mayweather is, you know, God forbid, he's a man, he's a human being, dead and gone, how many people will remember Floyd Mayweather for the great things that he did outside of the ring? You know what I mean?
Hey, I don't.
Like, nobody's going to remember your cars. Nobody's going to remember your, you know, the money team or any flashy thing you put on Instagram. Nobody's going to remember any of that. You know, people in boxing circles will remember that you're Floyd Mayweather and that you were a good fighter in your own right. But
it's what you do for humanity, what you do for a movement, what you change that makes your course in history. Like, you'll be
your
in the
legacy
books
extends beyond the
on
boxing
a list
ring
somewhere. But that's
in this
it
particular case of us talking about boxers, you know, it extends beyond that. And you know, I'm not down in Floyd Mayweather. He'll have a greater legacy than say I will.
Exactly.
Know? But long live the champ.
Yeah, man.
You know, what can we do, man? Life. One day it'll end for all of us. You know,
it ends. And that's one thing. Life definitely always, not to be morbid, but life ends.
It does.
It ends.
I mean, it does, man. Just hopefully you're comfortable with where you are, and you know when it does happen. You know, yeah, man. I mean,
you know, I was talking about I think we'll move on to...
I almost broke into a Whitney Houston, I Will Always Remember You rendition, but I didn't feel like singing, so... I was about to break into it, but I decided to draw that. Yeah. I don't want to sing on the podcast. But do you remember when she blew that?
We'll have a
down
separate podcast for that.
Always...
This is karaoke podcast. Yeah, you know. Me and Joe just singing.
you gotta admit, it would have went good at the end of that segment, you know, right there, though. That would have went good.
Hold on, maybe I can edit it.
Edit that in the podcast. Edit that in.
Put that drill in.
Yeah.
So speaking of how Muhammad Ali pretty much changed the game, not only for boxing but for civil rights and human rights. So, talking about this, the Roots movie, or not the Roots movie, but the Roots series that's airing on AMC.
The Roots miniseries.
The Roots miniseries airing on AMC right now.
Part, 2 hour each part or something like that? Or is it longer than that? I don't think it's an actual series. I think it's like a 10-part, an 8-part series. So they're going to break it up. Each part is going to be about 2 hours long or something like that.
Jesus, that's so, a long, that's a movie series. Per yeah. mini, per episode.
I think, I mean, it's a 2 hours story is a movie.
It is a long story.
I'm interested in it. As long as they do an accurate and good depiction
of the story.
Exactly. Like, don't, you know, don't try to glamorize it. Don't put any of that Hollywood buff on it. Just tell the story and tell it well, you know? Yeah, so my bad to interrupt your
No. Like, yeah, that's a good point. Like, so, I feel the same way. Like, as long as they are true to the story and they don't... I don't want them to fudge anything. Mm-hmm. I don't want them to make it... It's a depiction of an era that was extremely rough on black people. And I don't want them to... I don't want the directors to fudge any of the... The pain
to
kind of
clean
of,
that up a little bit. Don't
yeah,
clean
to
it
make
up.
It PC because yeah, be that's dirty. The show point of was. The show. The point of the show is to make it so people feel and understand what happened to these to African slaves mm-hmm. in that era at that time. You know, and that was the entire point of the show. So I definitely agree with you. Like, I don't want them to take it the easy way out. You know,
let it be dirty. Show how it was. We want the grime to show on this one. You know,
if you're gonna show it, show the pain. You mm-hmm. know. Like, that's what made the original Roots so powerful.
Yep, I was thinking, maybe I should go back and rewatch that to kind of refresh my memory on it.
I have it, if you want to borrow it.
And compare it to... Yeah, actually, I will, because I just moved to a new place. We don't have any cable right now, so I'm on DVDs for the next couple of days so we can get this cableman out here. So, perfect time for me to watch it.
Yeah, I started watching that joint again, mm-hmm. and I was like, oh, man. Like,
how long is it?
It's long.
Oh, Jesus.
It's episodes. It's like the DVD was in a booklet. Like, oh, snap. Like flipping through DVDs. Like, oh.
Yeah. Oh, man. They got an audio
book? It was a long book. Yeah, they have an audio book. I bet they have an audio book. Of course they do. But,
That's why I love the movie 12 Years a Slave so much. If you haven't, if you listen to this podcast, you haven't seen the movie 12 Years a Slave.
I haven't seen it.
With, oh man, what's the actor's name? And Gail Egypt, what's it for or something? So, look it up. 12 Years a Slave, IMDb.
Lumpia. Oh, Egypt.
It had Michael Fassbender played in it. He plays Magneto in all the newer X-Men movies. Latest X-Men movie just came out. Benedict Cumberbatch was in it. I know a lot of people might know who he is from some of his movies. You may not. But it was a very good movie. I think it was a very good, unpolished depiction of slavery, and it really showed not so much people being born into slavery, but the premise of that movie was the guy was kind of kidnapped away. He was a free man living in New York, I believe. He hooked up with these two white gentlemen who he was going to work for, play music. He played the violin, and the two men kidnapped him and sold him to slavers who sold him at auctions down south, and just said they were following him through the movie and his story and his plight. So he was a slave for 12 years. 12 years a slave. So, I mean, it was just a good depiction of how black people were kind of cattled and how we were picked. Like, we were picked like stock, you know? And yeah, I think it really did a good job of showing the pain that people went through. And now, this was a big budget movie, you know, from a movie production studio. So we'll have to see how this new Root series compares, being that it's a TV-produced miniseries. But
so the reason I brought this up was because of pretty much initially started with Snoop Dogg's comments on the series, which pretty much came down to, in a nutshell, was like, fuck this. Why are you going to show us how, again, why you got to dwell on how they did us, you know, on how they did black people in the era and how they took advantage, and not even just taking advantage, but really just tortured black people. And then, like, he had a lot of anger in his comments, you know? And I think it was well-placed anger. Like, his point was that what Hollywood tends to focus on is not, you know, slavery, yes, but I think he was also talking about more about the negativity of how the depiction of black people in Hollywood. So I don't want to just like limit this conversation to him just talking about, oh, all you do is make slave movies, which is kind of how I think his argument was skewed a bit.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know, man. It's, first of all, like, you know, Snoop saying this, they're trying to say this about black people, Hollywood. That may well be true. But, I mean, is there anybody in the world, just like I was asking about, is anybody who doesn't know who Muhammad Ali is? Does anybody care what Snoop thinks? I mean, seriously. Snoop. Honestly. I mean, I'll say I respect Snoop. I respect his career. You know, he's achieved things in his life that, you know, a lot of people don't. But as far as depicting, showing the way you depict black people in a certain light, my problem with Snoop is, you know, now people can change, but go back to 95, 96, and Snoop Dogg's dropping albums and his depiction of women in those albums. You know what I mean? And how she's a bitch this, and she's a hoe, and a hoe is a bitch. A bitch is a hoe. You know what I mean? So it's like, so you don't want Hollywood to portray black people in a certain way, but you have, in the past, to portrayed make women career. A certain way to make your career, to build up your name. So, I mean, which way are you trying to go, Snoop? I mean, do you still feel that way about women? I mean, I don't know, man. It's just who takes Snoop Dogg seriously in matters such as this? I don't.
I think
his opinion, fine. But I think whether I was or was not going to watch this series is not dependent on what Snoop Dogg thinks about it.
I think his opinion, though, kind of reflected what a lot of people do feel, though, a lot of black people feel. Like,
I don't think so.
I think it does. Like, I think for a good amount of people, like, so why do you think everybody is so excited about Black Panther? Like, other than the fact that Black Panther was amazing in Civil War, the fact is that we're taking not only a African depiction of a character, but we're taking the slavery out of it. We're taking an African hero. We're taking the hood out of it. We're taking the negativity. We're taking the ghetto out of it. And we're taking a king and we're putting him in his world where he is the ruler and he is a great character. Right. A great character telling a compelling story. Like, I think that's what people are starting to want more. Like, black people have this, and it's true. Like, the fact, it should never be taken for granted that black people, slavery was part of our history. That is undeniable. But to make that as the only way we are relevant, like the only way, as opposed to, even us just being opposed to that, is the only way we're relevant, I think is limiting our ability, limiting our storytelling.
I think some people might dig too deep into it. I mean, it's Roots, it's a remake of the original Roots series. So
I think it needs to be made.
Unless they were going to do something completely different from the beginning, what do people expect? It's a remake of the Roots miniseries. So that's what they're remaking. They're not making a new series about a new slave story that's new and that they're freshly telling. They're remaking the series. So, you know.
But maybe that's part of it too. Like,
I'm definitely excited about Black Panther, my damn self. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, I'll go back to the Afrofuturism. I'm always talking about Afrofuturism, but, like, that's one of the biggest things I believe in for black people. It's like, we need a platform to push black people into the future, you know, that is not always going to be tied to, and it can be, but not as the main feature of it, you know, tied to slavery. It's tied to the disparaging history of our people, you know? It can be a part of it, but we don't want it to be the main focus. We want the hero to be the hero. We want to be the protagonist, the real protagonist that's not cliche ghetto, I guess.
The gentleman who is executive producing on the Roots remake, LeVar Burton, starred as Kunta Kinte in the original series. Like I say, he serves as an executive producer on the revival. Previously told People magazine that he hopes the new version will spark conversation. He said he hopes to create a conversation about race, absent fear, anger, guilt, and shame. I don't know if this series will do that.
If it doesn't do that, then it's not succeeding.
People always get fearful and angry when you talk about race in any way. Some people do feel guilty and shameful. I'm pretty sure that there are some white people who do feel guilt and shame over the way that black people were treated by white people through the years.
And also white people who feel like that's how it's supposed to be.
I don't think we should shy away from remaking a series that came out already. I mean, you know, I do think they could portray black people in a different light, as they are with this Black Panther movie. But that's kind of different. That's superhero, you know. Is there any interest in movies and stuff like that now?
Here's an idea, though. So,
do you watch the show called Power?
No.
It comes on Stars. It's produced by 50 Cent. He's an executive producer.
But it's drug dealing, right?
Yeah, but it's a predominantly black and Latino cast. I think we could do more things like that.
It is
centered around selling drugs, but you're giving black people a platform to jump from. The star of the show, I forget his name, but you know, he was saying that he's gotten so many more opportunities after people have seen the show, you know. Even though that does depict drugs and all that, there are white people in there, there are Latino people. It's not just about black people slanging, hanging on the corner and selling dope, you know. I would like to see us have more opportunities for newer television series, whether it be about drugs or whatever. I'd like to see more opportunities for black people to have those shows. Predominantly black cast, predominantly Latino cast.
All right, so here's a question.
You have to take a shot, you know. Maybe remaking Roots wasn't the right way to do that.
Here's a question. Imagine
Snoop Dogg out of the equation. It's hard for me to take Snoop seriously.
Imagine if they took this opportunity, this slot, and they made a miniseries with a black character who was, I don't want to say hero, you know, because, you know, I do stick to comic books a lot. But imagine it was just a black protagonist who was leading a team against some enemy to complete a goal, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Like, let's say you take any, maybe even a black police officer who's doing the right thing and trying to, and fighting against crooked cops, you know? Mm-hmm. He's the one fighting against crooked cops. Like, let's take any other scenario. Like, they could have made any other movie. They could have made a science fiction movie where if you ever watched Alpha? So it's pretty much Heroes. Mm-hmm. It's pretty much Heroes. It's like Heroes and make the black person the main character in Heroes. Like, all I'm saying is that they have an entire huge spectrum of opportunity for movies and storylines, and just making the black person the equal opportunity character for these storylines.
These stories, yeah.
Right, but they don't. What they do, they
remake Roots.
They remake Roots. And not saying that Roots doesn't need to be remade. Now, here's my feelings on that. Like, I definitely think that Roots made a powerful impact back in the 80s. I think it was in the 80s. So it made a powerful impact in the 80s. A lot of people looked at it and was like, whoa, I didn't realize it was that bad. Mm-hmm. Like, we knew slavery existed, but to see slavery and to see torture and not more than discrimination, but rape, mm-hmm. like, to see it on such
a visceral level
where you're seeing it. Like, there's always a level between imagining, hearing, and then seeing something, mm-hmm. you know?
Which and is why to so actually many cops see it. And everything are getting in trouble nowadays, because people are recording.
Right, we're able to see it. It's not just black people allegedly making shit up. Mm-hmm. Like, it's on camera now. It actually happened. That's what makes it tangible to the mass. So during the 80s, that's what Roots did. I think that a lot of people today, black and white, understand that slavery was a big deal, obviously. But maybe not so many as we think. Maybe they remade it because they think that the topic needs to be pushed again. I don't know why they decided to remake it. Maybe they just need to put something on TV. They could have re-aired the old one, but you know what? People wouldn't watch it.
I don't either. I don't know why they decided to remake it, but my first initial thought when I saw the preview of the trailer for it was, man, I kind of want to see that, you know?
Yeah.
Now, Snoop's was, why do they keep making movies about us getting beat down and where they show us in a negative light and show the abuse we took?
I think both
everybody,
are good
everybody's
points.
Entitled to their own opinion. You know, I'm pretty sure there are people who would like to see this miniseries and don't mind them remaking it. I'm kind of with you. I'm on the side where I wouldn't mind seeing another show where you have a black or a minority lead figure, namely black. You know, we don't get enough starring roles. We are kind of always off in the background somewhere. We play second or sometimes even third fiddle to the main character.
Dude, I saw a meme the other
day. That's why I like Power, because there is a black star in the show,
but he's
predominantly black.
He's a protagonist, but is he? And I'm not saying all protagonists have to be good guys, but is he a good guy?
The story follows him. He is a good guy, but he is a drug kingpin. So,
right.
But in his heart, he is a good man. He takes care of his family. He does good for his community. You know what I mean? But at the end of the day, he does sell drugs, so he's not really a good guy. But I mean,
if drugs are legalized, I'm just talking about
the opportunity that these men have to play leading roles and show their talents in a TV show. You know what I mean? I'm with you. They could have more science fiction TV shows. They could have more shows where, you know, AMC could have chose to make anything. But, you know, they decided to remake Roots, and Snoop Dogg just has to live with it, you know? I think a lot of people, executive-wise and everything, are just, they're mad because Snoop has a loud voice on social media. Yeah. So if Snoop says boycott something, then, you know, they'll get mad because Snoop can easily reach probably 3 times the number of people they can just by putting something on Snapchat or Instagram.
That's true. I mean? Like, I initially watched that video because it was Snoop saying something about something. I was like,
people what are you talking about? Snoop. He's a polarizing figure.
What are you talking about?
Maybe AMC should throw him some money for an executive producer credit. Maybe Snoop will shut his mouth.
You brought some eyes to that, John.
I don't know. I don't take Snoop seriously. Like, let's take Snoop out of the equation and just talk about, you know, maybe they should have made something else besides Roots. But I want to see it either way. I'll check it out. Just for our podcast purposes, I'll check it out.
So Roland Martin did bring up a good counterpoint to Snoop, which a lot of those points we made. So Roland Martin is, a news anchor for NBC or something. Anyway, like you said before, he's definitely one of those guys who would have looked at Snoop and was like, I'm not listening to that.
He was never on Snoop's side from the beginning. I mean, I think he always associated Snoop with the negative side.
One of his points was, why don't you stop smoking weed?
What does that have to do with his views on them making the movie Roots? That has nothing to do with it, you know. So he was already kind of pre-biased towards Snoop before Snoop even started
preaching.
Yeah,
but he did have some good points talking about pretty much things like it's something blacks need to be watching. Maybe more black producers or black celebrities need to be funding movies like a Marcus Garvey movie, which would be amazing to see a Marcus Garvey movie. Or Huey P. Newton movie, which is another one to talk about.
Maybe we should do a segment of our next podcast specifically focused on Marcus Garvey, because a lot of people don't know who he is and they don't know his accomplishments. And
I read his memoirs. He was a brilliant person,
and they don't have any idea who he even is. You know what I mean? Like,
a lot of black people.
Can we get a Marcus Garvey movie? Maybe that's what they should have made instead of this Roots movie, or Roots miniseries. They should have made a Marcus Garvey miniseries. Yep. See, the debating table came in.
We got the debating table.
Yeah, we got the debate.
We should have made a Marcus Garvey movie.
Like Kevin Hart. Sorry, this is my debating thing.
I think I shook the...
Yeah, you know.
Yeah, definitely smacked the table. Yeah, exactly. That's a good point.
Yeah,
but
I would have loved to see a Marcus Garvey movie. But would that have brought in the same audience as Roots?
It would have brought in a bigger audience. It would have brought in the garbage. Because here's the thing. Like, people would have found out. It doesn't take a huge Google search. Who the fuck is Marcus Garvey?
Hey,
Star Line.
You want to do a segment specifically devoted to Marcus Garvey next time? We can. I'm definitely down with it.
Maybe not next time, but we can do it eventually.
We can do a whole podcast on Marcus Garvey.
Right? Yo. All right. We should definitely do that, Joe. I was about to throw it. So I was still talking about the idea of the audiobooks. And we could do a Marcus Garvey audiobook discussion. Mm-hmm. But in the future, everybody, stay tuned.
Stay tuned.
We're going to get our Twitter up soon. And Dee's going to be in charge of the Twitter. And you're going to be tweeting all kinds of stuff.
I'll tweet.
Tweet.
Yeah. Tweet. Yeah, man. But I think that guy was pretty biased towards Snoop already from the jump. When he first saw the article Snoop Dogg says come up on his news feed or wherever he first heard about the story of Snoop Snapchatting and telling people to boycott. He's right though. I mean,
why doesn't Snoop
fund another independent film? Snoop has the resources and the clout to put something together where he could, you know, get behind an independent film or independent miniseries.
Even if he just endorsed it.
Yeah, people just endorse it and, you know, people would be interested because his name is associated with it.
A lot of rappers, so, honestly. I wonder why.
Don't get on Snapchat or Instagram or whatever and start saying that people should boycott something because of your feelings. I mean, you know, to me, if anybody heard that and is not going to watch it because Snoop said so, you're kind of an idiot, you know.
Yeah.
Like, who cares what Snoop says, you know.
I definitely looked at it and was like, all right, I feel him. But I remember watching Roots when I was a kid. I watched it with my parents.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember sitting with them and looking at them like, am I supposed to be watching this? Like, that was disturbing to me. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, like, it was something I definitely, looking back, I was like, yeah, I needed to see that. I needed to know that jump.
I think, and going back to 12 Years a Slave, that is a movie that every black person should see.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think it, to me, it wasn't sensationalized or it wasn't, you know, it really showed the pain and the suffering that this man and that black people went through at that time, and the way that they were treated like cattle. They had no rights, you know. They were property, you know. But you know, who cares what Snoop says? I would like to see him film something a little more independent and, you know, make a bigger stand than just putting something on Instagram
that instead of saying I don't like, about you do something?
Yeah, how about you do instead of I don't? You know, but that's cool.
You do, I don't.
Yeah, he do, I don't. So that's Snoop in a nutshell. So what do you want to go to this?
He do, I don't.
This Baltimore pastor.
Yeah, man.
All right. So in transition,
explain that.
We still have to figure out our transitional signal. In dialogue while we're talking about the wink and the nod.
Yeah. That was just uncomfortable.
Yeah, maybe we should get in like a third person to point at us when it's transition time, you know.
Double gun point.
Yeah. So maybe our transitional audio should be like a gun cock with two shots, you know what I mean? Remember
what? I don't know.
You remember the song back in the day, it's like doom, doom.
Oh, yeah. That's right. That was part of the beat, though.
Yeah, that could be, you know, something a little gangsta up in this podcast. Get some gangstaisms up here.
Man, we just talked about pro-black for the last 30 minutes.
We're going to get
double gun cracking at you.
Fine. Shoot my ideas down. Brat. Place. Yeah, you know, like, brat, brat.
Next topic. Brat,
brat. Okay, so next topic. There was a video that went viral a few days, maybe a week ago, maybe a little longer than that, of a Baltimore megachurch pastor named Jamal Bryant, who was apparently walking around downtown Baltimore trying to speak to youth and handing out flyers and, from all intents and purposes in the video, trying to be more or less positive. In the video, he was approached by another gentleman, whose name I have here is PFK Boone. And you might not know it because he says it in the video, but it sounds like a gang title or something like that when he says the joint.
It's PFK Boone.
Yeah. So, but you know, basically, the guy asked him what's he doing here and what he's done for the streets. And I'm pretty sure everybody should have seen this video by now. And then all of a sudden, the guy starts getting really boisterous and hand wavy and, don't come down here no more, you know, tells the dude, we don't even want you in our city. And I'm speaking for the streets, you know, and just going a little bit too.
He was extra.
Yeah, a little bit extra on the guy. Basically, at the end of the video, the pastor, he tells the pastor to leave, and the pastor obviously is nervous or even scared because he gets up and leaves. And you can see him walking all the way up the street in the background of this video. Which was messed up. They could have faded to black or something. You didn't have to show us walk. You didn't have to show him walking all the way to the back. You know?
Yo, when she was in that dope spitting that rhyme punk. And he was still in the background, yeah. I was like, damn, so long
even,
in the street.
I don't even count that as part of the video. When that girl stopped up and started rhyming, I'm like, okay, well.
I lost interest.
Yeah, who cares what you got to say. But yeah, basically, then the pastor took to Instagram after the incident, I guess after the video went viral, and he put a meme up that says...
I don't think that was his meme, just for a point.
Well, he posted the meme as, you know, in his post. But basically it said, you know, gangsters or whatever be running the city, and there's a picture of four or five black guys with guns lined up on the top. And then he said, we run these streets, ... really. And on the bottom, there's a picture of a Asian store owner and a Indian store owner and a Puerto Rican store owner. And basically trying to make the point that you don't run anything. You know, you standing outside, you know, on the corner, saying you run your neighborhood doesn't mean you actually run your neighborhood from a business political standpoint. You know, you don't own anything. You know, you don't have any investments in your neighborhood, you know, besides the fact of walking around and talking about how you rep your hood. But my opinion of the video, I just think the guy was going a little bit too hard, you know.
PF Boom.
Yeah, PFK Boom, whose real name is Devon Neverden.
I gotta put his government out there, man.
Well, you know, he put himself out there when he let himself be recorded in a video that went viral on the internet.
PFK Boom.
I just think he went a little too hard on it. You know, it's like, explain yourself like an intelligent man. You know, don't come up there with all the arm waving and the, we don't even want you on our streets. Can you understand that? You know, yelling, and who knows how many guys he had behind him. You know what I mean? He probably had the goon squad standing behind him. Yeah, you know, so even if the pastor had opened his mouth to speak back, which obviously he didn't, he was scared, if you look at the video. Even if he had opened his mouth to speak back, I don't think he would have been able to communicate with this guy, PFK Boom, on an intelligent level. He was already amped up and too hyped.
So, just to play devil's advocate, you know, I don't know the entire situation going on out there between Jamal O'Brien and PFK Boom and his organization, but the first thing that strikes me as awkward, or at least as a red flag, is Jamal Bryant is the pastor of a mega church. If you know what a mega church is,
one of those churches you see on Sunday morning,
right?
And he's recording.
They got a broadcast auditorium, and they got 50,000 people in that joint on Sunday, and he and that joint just talking about whatever, giving his opinion. So I always kind of feel like there's something
kind of off
with that. So I'm sure I'm not the only person that feels that way, and I'm sure there's a lot of people that feel completely opposite. It's simply my opinion. So when they see this guy who's the leader of a mega church in their community, I assume he's in their community, and doesn't seem to be helping, but he's there all of a sudden after a lot of the heavy work and the heavy pushing has passed, you can kind of understand where some negativity may come from. Like, why are you here now? Like, you out here. You weren't out here when shit was hitting the fan.
Things were getting rough.
You know?
In his defense, though, who wants to be out there when things are getting rough? I would have left. I wouldn't have been in those streets in Baltimore either when they were out there rioting.
Right, but would you go later expecting credit? Or would you go later expecting... like most people wouldn't. But that's this guy's game, though. If you have a mega church, you play by certain rules to gain that many followers. It's not just nobody's listening to your message, but you know what? He's better than that pastor.
He wasn't
over here.
Just driving by going somewhere else and just happened to stop in his neighborhood. He went there
looking for attention.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where a lot of negativity. He did.
I think now, a lot of times these mega churches, people get a lot of negative image of the pastors of these churches. I don't know so much, but I'm pretty sure the guy Jamal Bryant, maybe Sundays he wears a nice expensive suit. You know what I mean? He might have a nice watch on, and people see him on TV and they're like, man, you're supposed to be living for God, but you obviously have a lot of material possessions. You know what I mean?
I think he was out there on the durag.
So, well, yeah, he was trying to look to play the part. You know what I mean? The black guy walking around downtown Baltimore. There's a lot of black people around. Would you want to walk in there with a nice suit and a nice watch?
Once again, that would rub your average person the wrong way. Oh, you gonna dress up now?
Yeah, but I mean, if you see him on Sundays, if you see him on Sundays in his broadcast, he has to look nice, you know.
Oh yeah, definitely.
I don't know, but my thing is, we're sitting here filling in the blanks for this guy PFK Boom.
That's true.
We're filling in the blanks of his argument. We're trying to. Well, he might have been trying to say he should have took a step back. Calm down, not get so amped up, and explain himself a little more clearly and accurately, because to me, it was a whole bunch of garble coming through, and he was just a little too gangster, and you're not going to get the respect of even if his point he was trying to make, his idea behind what he was saying was right and justified, you're not going to draw a lot of attention to that side when you come across that way, you know?
Yeah,
if you were going to step to him that way and be that angry about it, maybe you should have had a friend, you know, step up to him. And in this guy's defense, PFK Boom, or Devon Neverden, he's a grassroots activist, PFK Boom, Devon Neverden. He started an outreach program for B-More's most dangerous citizens called 300 Gangsters. And basically, I guess that's a reform program. He himself was acquitted of murder in 1993 and spent more than 3 years in solitary confinement. So now, with his program, he speaks out against such forms of punishment.
So he's an activist. Like, he speaks a certain way because... Maybe he speaks a certain way because how people understand him, where he's from. And from spending
3 years in solitary confinement, you can kind of understand some of the anger that comes across when he talks. You know, especially something that he's impassioned about, like this subject. I just think in the video, he didn't explain himself clearly. It was a little too... And I'm a black guy, you know. I'm not trying to say I'm a gangster or anything like that, but the way he was speaking, I didn't clearly understand what he was trying to say, why he was so angry, you know.
But here's the thing.
Maybe he should have had a friend speak for him. But maybe in the moment, you see the guy walking by, and you step up, and your
feelings come up. Like, he didn't make that statement for media. That went viral on its own. Like, things go viral... For whatever reason, viral for hopping on desks and smacking.
This video might have went viral because it was Jamal Bryant.
Maybe,
possibly, I don't know.
Maybe it's because he got viral because he got chewed out. Mm-hmm. Whatever the reason is, like, this guy wasn't making a statement for the internet to translate. And but at the same time, I agree with you that, you know, a clear speaking pattern, I guess, is useful for your point.
And anybody who sees that video and maybe wants to help, would anybody who sees that video and says, you know what, he started an outreach program, I'd like to help him, you're limiting your opportunities for people to help by speaking that way, you know?
Yeah,
you could have opportunities to have more people in your program or help out with your program, be a part of your program, and he didn't know the video was going to go viral. Maybe if he knew it was going to get this level of attention, he would have chosen somebody else to speak for him, or... He would have been a little more clear about what he was trying to say. But I'm just saying, what he said just didn't come across well. It came across a little bit too gangster. And I think the guy Jamal Bryant posting that meme afterwards, that was a low blow, man, because he's totally right. You know what I mean? Like,
I don't know.
Not doing anything by standing out there in the corner yelling at Jamal Bryant for walking around and being a stain on black people in his community. You know,
if he's a pastor of a mega church, he's doing, he at least has something, right. He at least has something that you could use,
you know, for your message. Something that he can use for your message, exactly, to bolster your own program.
I mean, passions are high at times, you know, but sometimes stepping back is a good way to look at a situation, find something you don't like, and be able to use it to your advantage. But like, at the same time, I feel you, if you don't want to do that shit, I don't blame you. I mean, sometimes you just got to tell people no on the principle of it.
People are a product of their environment. So if this guy, PFK Boom, was raised this way, that's how he is. He spent time in prison.
I'm telling you, just how he speaks. Solitary
confinement. So yeah, that might just be how he is. That's the way he speaks. It's not that he's not an intelligent guy and he doesn't know how to explain himself clearly, communicate, you know.
It's no word.
But it's just, that's the way he speaks, and especially when he gets impassioned about something. I'll give him the benefit of doubt on that, but...
Like, he wasn't speaking for, to be viewed by the mass of everybody. Mm-hmm. So, I think that's a good point we should take into account. Like, if he wanted to come out and make another statement as to, like, why he went off like that, or why he made that statement, then I think people would be pretty receptive to him.
Mm-hmm.
At least half of the people who aren't in the church. If you got 50,000 people in your church, that's a lot of people just already break against you. But even still, like, if you wanted to come out and make another statement more clear and clarify what he was saying, like, at the moment, he was impassioned. He felt like this guy was on his territory and doing something that was not beneficial for his movement and doing something that was probably going to work counter to his movement, or was trying to take credit for something that they as a community did without him, you know?
But...
Understand that. Right, right. Explain so that. I feel like if he wanted to make another statement, then he should do that.
Because the way you're coming across, you're even turning off black people that would see the video. They're saying, man, this dude just acting like a thug. He's just acting like a gangster. Nobody wants to pay attention to that, you know? I mean, it's, you know, when you're dealing with within the political realm or even a religious realm, you know, you're not going to get a lot of cred speaking that way. You know, you don't get street cred in the political arena or the religious arena. You know what I mean? There's no such thing as that. So
that is not a thing.
Have a way to explain yourself properly.
Unless you're Hillary Clinton. She can do the Dougie. Do you know that? She
can do the... Hillary Clinton can do the Dougie?
Oh, yes.
Oh, my God. So
she's a...
I don't want to transition unless we're ready, but we didn't talk about this, you know, this little Bernie Sanders entering to, what did he enter to? The DMX? Where the hood at?
Oh, yeah.
Where the hood at? Oh, my God. Nah. I said, what is
Hold on. I think that could have been a coincidence.
And by the way, guys,
that wasn't a particularly black audience. I'm
all
just
of
gonna
these,
say that.
All these things we're talking about, of course, obviously, Muhammad Ali, we started out with, even Snoop Dogg versus the Roots, the Baltimore passer named Jamal Bryant. You can find all these videos on YouTube, World Star Hip Hop.
We'll link some articles in the descriptions.
Just so you guys know.
In the doobly-doo, just look below.
But also on World Star Hip Hop or YouTube is Bernie Sanders. And he's speaking at a rally sometime last week. And he comes out, his introduction music is DMX. Where the hood at for his introduction music. So he comes out on stage, where the hood at. And you know, when I see this joint, I'm just scratching my head like, okay, if we're going to roast Donald Trump for his views, and his views are crazy and he says stupid stuff. And I fully believe Bernie Sanders' intentions were good, but come on, bro. That's a bad look. Don't do that. You could have came out to anything. You could have just came out to cheers and applause. Where the hood at? Like, are you trying to play on the trope of
Well, hold black on, people? Like, so that's the thing. To Hillary me, he's Clinton trying comes to ride out the to coattails. Hillary Clinton comes out to Beyonce and Rihanna like all the time on some political feminist movement shit. Like, I feel like, and that's the thing. So Bernie didn't come out. Like, you saw the audience.
But
in there.
Where the
they
hood at though?
They were not a predominantly black. If he was song. In Chicago and he came out to that joint and the audience was all black. I'd have been like, all right, Bernie.
He could have came out,
son.
He could have came out to Rewind. He could have came out to Common and Erykah Badu or something like that. You know what I mean? He could have came out to I Like the Way You Move by Outkast or something like that. He could have came out to anything, man. You got to come out to Where the Hood At. I just don't like that, man. I thought that was like a bad look. It's like, come on, Bernie. Like,
I don't
you know?
Think so. I think
it's kind of
matters.
Like a desperate attempt.
The audience
to,
matters.
It's a desperate attempt to connect with the younger. Black, especially, but minority population. People see the way that people got up and moved for President Obama. Everybody moved in one direction for Obama. You know,
wait,
you got all those black votes.
But what made you think that's what Bernie
Hillary,
was trying
I think
to do?
Hillary and Bernie are both trying to grab some of that audience.
The black vote.
You don't come
Hillary's
out with
got the black vote though.
You don't come out with Where the Hood At. Not like President Obama did. You know how people are. Everybody's racist to a certain extent. People knew they were voting for Obama before they even got to the primaries or before they knew they were going to vote
black
for Obama.
Black people were voting for Obama before they knew who Obama was.
Exactly.
It was like, who is this Obama?
Vote.
He
soon
black?
As we saw this guy come out with dark
shit.
Skin,
you know, I'm
we
sorry,
already
guys.
Knew. So it was unfair in that way. And I think they're trying to latch on to the coattails of that a little bit. Where the hood at? Like, come on, man. It was only like a 34, 35 second clip. Go to World Star Hip Hop YouTube, check
Bruh,
it out.
Bruh, that's not what he was going for.
But I just, well, that's the way it came across. I mean, if anybody
Why?
Sees that.
Because somebody posted it
he
like
came
that?
Out to Where the Hood
Look,
At.
Look, somebody saw
it's
that,
the,
don't.
It's the lyrics
reposted.
Of the song.
Dude, that's not what he was coming out for. It was a hype song. That
I
was
wish,
it.
I almost wish they would have let him
The
talk
audience
after
was
that.
White.
Like, they didn't really even show a clear. They really didn't even show a clear.
I saw two black hands, and one of them was brown from an Indian.
But I mean,
person.
We only saw a small sliver of the crowd. We don't know who was in the background, how many people attended this rally. I
that
mean,
was in.
That
what
was
it?
Definitely an attempt, if not to connect with black.
It was in
younger
California.
People. It was an attempt to connect with younger people in general.
It was in California.
My beef with it is where is you could have came out to Rihanna. You could have came out to Lil Yachty or whatever, Lil Uzi. You could have came out to anything. You got to come out to Where the Hood At. Listen to the word.
L-I-L.
Where the Hood At. Like, come on, man. Where the hood? Hottie. Who says the hood? Black people. The hood. Yeah, no, white people going to be like, I'm going back to the hood. I live in the hood, you know? That's a connotation to black folks, man. And I think that was a bad look. He could have chosen any other song.
He could have been referring to the Cud covering on his jacket.
I almost wish they had a show Bernie, because you saw him in the background towards the end of the video come out, maybe the last 5 seconds. I wish they could have showed him, like, maybe walk across the stage and he's in that joint doing this or something like that.
No! No!
he's in that joint playing up the crowd, waving his hands. Where the hood? Where the hood? Where the hood at? Like, he should have, like, danced to it a little bit.
No, that'd have been worse. Oh, man. I'd have been with you if he did that shit. If he did that joint, I was like,
he came out that joint. Where the hood? Like, he'd been raising the roof and whatnot.
If he started barking, I'd be with you. Like, yo, all right, Bernie, you fucked up.
He'd have got on the mic. Where my hood?
Oh, the meanness and the beanness.
You know what I mean? Oh, man. Yeah, I didn't like it, man. I know that was an awkward transition. We were just talking about this Baltimore pastor, but it popped into my mind. And sometimes we, on the Tell Us Your Idea Talkers podcast, we like to just let the conversation flow. So you might have some awkward transitional moments sometimes where we go from subject to subject, but
I think
it's all well-spirited.
I think if they listen to the other 4 episodes before this, they kind of get it. Like,
man, but yeah, that was a bad look, Bernie. Where the hood at? I mean, you could have picked any other song. You could have picked Jay-Z, Reason But Doubt. I'm out for presidents to represent me. Get money about for presidents to represent me. You know what I mean? Why you couldn't pick a song like that?
Honestly, that'd
Where
been
the
dope.
Hood at?
On some real shit, that'd have been dope.
It would have been kind of cool, you know? I'm out for presidents to represent me. You know, you could have picked that. That would have been cool. It would have been clean.
Been cool.
And you would have did the same thing. You connected with the younger
Bernie
generation
camp? Listen to
with
that
a
shit.
Better message.
I'm out for presidents to represent me.
But the lyrics of the song that he chose, now I don't know who chose the song, but he agreed to walk out to it. You know, you have to understand, he agreed to walk out to it. Where the hood at?
Here's the thing.
I just thought that was a bad look, man.
Zero chance. Bernie was like, you know what song I want to walk out to?
Where the hood at?
Where the hood at? I got my DMX CD right here, son.
Look, they said, what song you want to walk out to, Bernie? He was like, yo, let me get my DMX CD out the car. I was just bumping that joint this morning.
I got that joint right here, son.
Yeah,
it's on my phone.
I got this shit right on my phone, man. I got my MP3 player right here, so.
Yo, how many? I bet Bernie Sanders ain't even got MP3s on his phone, son.
Bernie Sanders.
He probably still got records.
Bernie should have came out that joint goose walking. He should have came out that pimp walking and whatnot.
You'd be doing the dab?
Yeah, doing the two-step and whatnot, man. Bernie Sanders should have did the Harlem Shake to Where the Hood At, man. Wow. I mean, yeah, you're right. If he just started hamming it up and started dancing across the stage and playing up the crowd.
That's the shit that fucking kills me, because Hillary will do that shit. And that shit makes me cringe every goddamn time.
I think Bernie Sanders already has the ear of anybody younger, minority, black, who's paying attention to this. He already has our ears.
Yeah,
because we like the message that he's putting across.
Like, it's not a black white thing.
I don't even
Bernie.
Pay attention to her. If she came out to Beyonce or something like that, it's fine. Whatever. I don't even pay you no mind, you know? But if she would have came out to Where the Hood At, oh my God, that's blatant. Now that's blatant right there, you know? Come on, what do you know about the hood? Spell hood, Hillary. Spell hood. You know? Spell the hood. You know?
Wrong. It's with a D.
Mm-hmm. She's going to be like, T-H-E. Wrong. It's D-A. I said the hood.
The hood.
Yeah. You know, the hood. The neighborhood. Yeah, but, you know, come on, Bernie. You got to do better than that, man. And I understand you might be just about out of the race by now, but you got to do a little better than that, man. People are getting more intelligent, you know, as times go on. And, you know, little stuff like that, you know, maybe back in the day we might have been a little more accepting of something like that, you know, but now in this kind of political climate where everybody has access to information and we form our own ideas without our ideas being given to us, that's just a bad look, man. You know, don't come out to Where the Hood At. So if you're running for president, you're listening to this podcast and you plan on running for president and you're an older white gentleman, do not come out to Where the Hood At as your introduction song.
In fact, if you
white, do not.
Don't play Where the Hood At.
Do not play Where the Hood At, okay?
You could be young. Don't do it.
Like, you gotta come out to, like...
Bad idea.
Maybe if he came out to, like, Boys to Men or something, you know? Yeah, something a little
Why
younger.
Don't we
yeah,
go...
Well, if he came out to R. Kelly or something like that, you know?
Alright.
Yeah. You know, don't come out to Where the Hood At, Bernie. Yeah, Jesus. Okay.
All right, I'm
gonna. No, go ahead. What's your point? I was just about to ask. Is this one of those awkward transitional moments that we have? But...
Well, I mean, we could definitely pivot from there. Talking about Where the Hood At, I guess it's not really a good transition, but we could talk about how the people are racist in China.
Oh my God. Okay.
So the hood in China, you see.
All right. So there was this Chinese ad for laundry detergent that you once again you can find it on YouTube, World Star Hip Hop. Type in racist Chinese detergent ad, and it'll pop up. So
it turns out black people on the inside, once we were washed, are Asian.
I was not expecting that Asian guy to pop out of that damn washer. Okay, when I first saw that video, I was like, okay, so maybe his shirt's gonna be clean or something, but he's gonna come out, and up pops this Asian guy. Okay, so let's explain the video. Okay,
with lipstick.
So this girl's in there, she's washing clothes, and now it's a Chinese detergent ad, so everything's in Chinese. It's not an American ad. So, but there's just music playing. There's actually no dialogue in the commercial. So,
because he don't speak Chinese.
He doesn't speak Chinese. We actually don't even know what that black guy was. And I feel him. He's trying to get paid. Yeah, you know, a commercial. He's an aspiring actor. They offered him a commercial. You take that. You take that money, you know. Take that credit. So, so the girl's sitting there washing laundry. So, she has her back turned. A black gentleman comes up to the corner. He's paint stained a little bit. It wasn't over the top paint staining in. There was like a splash here on his shirt, splash there, mainly on his shirt. You know, it's a detergent ad. So I'm thinking, okay, they're trying to show that his shirt is dirty, you know? So he whistles at the girl after he leans up against the wall. She turns around and kind of fingers him over there, you know, points, you know, does a finger for him to come over there. So they're coming in close and they're swooning a little bit. You think that maybe he's going to kiss her. All of a sudden, she stuffs a detergent pad in his mouth, right? It then stuffs him into the washing machine. Now, that was funny. I was laughing at that. I was like, okay, wow. She just stuffed this motherfucker. And he had the Jordans on, too. I've seen him jump, man. Yeah. Some nice Jordans on.
I guess that, but yeah.
Stuffed him into the washing machine, right? Sat on top of the washing machine. You know, you get the impression a couple minutes go by. All of a sudden, the top opens, and an Asian guy pops out of the washing machine. So she starts making out with the Asian guy, and, you know, they do their little end of commercial in Chinese, and they show the laundry detergent. End of ad. What the fuck? Yo, I mean, I cannot believe that Chinese guy popped out of that damn washer machine, man. I was like, what? Wait a minute. What are you trying to say? So, did you wash the nigga off this dude? So, you washed the nigga off? This detergent is so good, you can wash a nigga off of a
nigga? Hashtag wash the nigga off.
Yeah, wash the nigga off. That's my laundry detergent from now on.
That's bullshit.
Wow. Can you be that blatantly racist in China?
Obviously, you can in China. So, here's the situation.
Did you see that? You saw that? I could not believe that, y'all. I was like, I mean, it was funny. My first initial reaction was to laugh. I laughed at it at first. I said, man. But then when I sat back and thought about it, I said, Jesus, that's blatant.
That shit is blatant.
That is in your face. Like, I will wash your ass into a Chinese guy. You know what I mean? So they washed the black off this man. That's basically what they did.
Washed them Asian.
That's some powerful laundry detergent, son.
I don't know if that's pro-Asian or just mega black, man, but... They was not filling. So the whole real issue with that is like, hey, black don't wash off. That's who we are, goddammit.
Wow.
Like, obviously. Like, this is not a condition.
I couldn't believe she washed genetics. The nigga off this guy, dog. My bad. My apologies if you do not like the word nigga, but that's what she did. Watch the
she
ad.
She washed
YouTube.
The black off, man.
She washed the black off this guy. I said, man, I mean, if they couldn't release that commercial in America, you have
she was
so
online,
much backlash
like shit,
to that. Okay, so
apparently that joint was this was a remake of an Italian ad.
Did the same thing happen? Was it
yeah,
black guy?
So it was pretty much the same situation. It was kind of different, but it was an Italian guy and the girl. She was doing laundry. The Italian guy comes up. I don't remember if she stuffs the cube in his mouth, but she definitely jams him into the washing machine with the detergent, and out comes this huge buff black like muscle model out that jump. And
so
they kind of took the ad and reversed it. So they kind of took the ad and reversed it from it. So apparently, after you wash off the black,
people are crazy. So apparently,
Asian, before that, we were Italian.
You said this was an Italian commercial?
It was an Italian commercial.
Apparently, I need to move to Italy. Black people, they want to wash their like Italians than the black people.
But no, you know,
I'm staying away from China.
Ain't no
loving.
Ain't no loving.
You know what I mean? They'll strap me to the train tracks out there and run me over the train. So going on this Chinese ad, it said backlash to the ad has been swift. Highlighting it as yet another display of blatant racism in China that can leave you completely dumbfounded, which it definitely did for me. Do you see this? Do you see my debating finger hitting the table?
Yeah, it's hitting the table.
Blatantly, completely dumbfounded. What the fuck?
That shit was blatant.
I mean, goddamn, man.
Like, but it's China, dude. How much more
racist can you get? I guess I completely don't get... And I'm not saying that everybody in China feels this way. Like I said before, everybody's racist to a certain extent. Man, it's crazy. Like, black people can't be viewed like that in Asia, can they? I mean...
Yes. Dude, have you ever watched anime? Have you ever seen a black person feature in anime? Just pop up?
No. Not that I can...
Probably for the best, my brother.
No. We had Popo on Dragon Ball Z.
Close enough.
Hey, that's close. Popo? He was black.
He was black. He was short, round, big lipped, wide eyes.
Hey, he did have some big ass lips, though.
Man, she was some bullshit, goddamn. We knew who Popo was supposed to be.
We had Popo, though, in Dragon Ball Z.
And he was in the clouds with the alien.
You know? Hey, so, he wasn't on Earth with all the white people.
I guarantee. They kept him in the clouds. He wasn't an alien. Damn. He was from Africa.
They never did say where Mr. Popo was from, did they? Jeez.
They couldn't.
So, yeah, man, I mean, I was completely dumbfounded, man. I did not expect this guy. I always kind of expect the best out of humanity. You know, everybody's racist. Everybody's a little bit ignorant in their own right. But humanitarian-wise, we're talking about human beings. You know what I mean? Like, can people really be that racist towards another group of people? Like, I myself see the differences between black people, between white people, between Asian people, you know, but in my heart of heart, I don't see myself being completely and utterly like racist to the point where I'm like, they don't even exist or they're not humans. You know what I mean? To me, this ad is depicting that you almost want to wash the black off of people. You know, it's so dirty. You're so dirty, it'll turn you from dark to light. You know what I mean?
So here's the thing. So black people carry a stigma in
as far as humanitarianism. And I can't believe that people are looked at that way in another country, even though they're looked at like that here in America. But, I mean, Jesus, man.
So black people carry a negative stigma, like, throughout the world, man. Like, you go to any other country, it doesn't matter. Like, you go to any country... Black people are always treated differently from Europe to Asia to
America,
South America, even Brazil. African American or black people are treated negatively throughout the world in different cultures.
Why do you think that is? Why do you think people have such a negative view of?
I can't look at you when I'm talking.
Of black people, and why do you think that is, man? I don't know. You know,
racism.
Maybe sometimes in America, like.
It is racism. Like, that's it. That's what race. That's
you
what
might think a guy is like a thug or gangster. He walks in, he's black. He's got hair and dreads, and he might have on some clothes. And he's like, oh, look at this guy. And then, you know, you walk up to him, and, you know, he says, the black guy who just walked in that you think is a gangster says, hi, sir, how you doing? Can I help you out today? And he speaks to you and tells you. And it's like that first impression when you look at somebody. I kind of understand the racism in that. You first get to know somebody. You know, you don't judge a book by its cover, right? But, I mean, it's hard for me to comprehend the blatant, in-your-face racism of countries, you know, in this article, as depicted by China and India. Inescapable racism and ignorance faced by Africans in China and India.
So there's an article by the Washington Post written by Ishan Thardor, who, the name of the article is China and India have a huge problem with racism towards black people. This isn't a Washington Post. It's not a secret. Like, maybe it was kind of under or overlooked for a while, but it's definitely something that happens pretty regularly. And it talks about a man named Masanda Kitenda Oliver, who was beaten to death. He was from the Congolese nation, and he was pretty much killed over a situation with a dispute over the hiring of a rickshaw. And during the beating from the local people, they were yelling racist slurs at him the entire time. This is something it's not new. Like, we've always, my main reference for the Asian culture is anime, kung fu movies. If you ever see a black person in those things, it's always something that's hideous. Like, the person is always,
I can't recall either, ever seeing a black person.
He's either 100% cliche. He's either 100% cliche, which means he's huge, he's muscular, his lips are massive, and he's black as fuck, right? So he doesn't really look human to them. And so something like this is always, it's not new, you know? And then also in Brazil, they had a situation with a carnival queen. She had been practicing her whole life to become the carnival queen, and from not only white Brazilians in the area, but also from the black Brazilians down there. They say she was too black to be the carnival queen. They're saying that she was better off situated in the kitchen cooking for, you know, whoever.
I don't know, man. I don't know. I'm not even as racist against any. I'll be more racist against an individual person than a group or a classification of people. You know what I mean? Like, if I don't like you as a person, then I'm like, forget you. I don't like this guy. But if 8 white people or 8 black guys or 8 Asian guys walk into the store after I walked in, I don't immediately look at them and think anything, you know? I mean, I don't know, man. I always try to look for the best, like, humanitarian-wise in people, and it's just hard for me to fathom, you know, that this level of racism is still out there, man, even though it is. I don't know why black people around the world are looked at in such a light. And maybe not around the world. I'm sure there are countries that don't have these problems. The problem with India and China is, as stated in that article, is they have two of the most dynamic, booming, fastest-growing economies in the world. So they do attract a lot of people. If you're moving from a country in Africa and you want to go somewhere to try to make it, you would go to a country like India or China or America to try to situate yourself and make some money. I mean, geez, man, people still being dragged through the streets and beaten to death, you know? And who knows why the guy was beaten to death? Maybe he was just the first guy they grabbed. Maybe they were yelling the racist slurs at him because he was the first guy they grabbed and so he happened to be black.
Dispute over auto rickshaw. So I don't know what happened during that dispute, but maybe he got something that somebody else wanted, or maybe he was mad because he couldn't get the ride. You know, like the rickshaws are like taxi rides, you know? Maybe he couldn't get one, he got pissed off, and then they retaliated. Who knows? But it was over something as simple as that, which escalated to the point of them beating him to death.
Still crazy, though, man. That's barbaric, you know? People being dragged through the streets and beaten. I mean, I guess maybe over here in America, we lived a little more sheltered of a life where those kind of acts don't happen so much. I'm not sure how prominently they happen in India or China, but
so you tie those.
If you are able to release a laundry detergent ad such as this one that was released, I mean, you'd have to imagine that nobody cared if they released this commercial. You know, people didn't care if this ad was racist. You know, they wanted to sell laundry detergent, so they let it go through.
I mean, it was funny. I mean, people found it funny up to a certain point, and only black people probably found it offensive.
It was funny. And of course only black people find it offensive. I think only black people...
Or people who are empathetic.
People are empathetic. White people can be empathetic towards black offenses, but black people are the main ones that get offended by black offenses, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you know, you can have a white person that's totally sympathetic towards a black offense, but they're not black. So that offense doesn't really affect them. They still have the right to be offended by it, though, so, you know.
Or maybe like black people offended by like,
man, I don't see how you can look at a commercial such
Native
as this
Americans deal with
and think that this is not offensive. I don't know how anybody, white, black, or whatever, Asian, can look at this commercial and say, oh, that's fine, that's a good commercial.
That's the thing. That it's not racist. In America. It's not in America. And in China, this might have been totally cool. Nobody probably had a problem with that.
It's
They're
hard
not
for me
worried.
To imagine any Chinese person looking at this and saying, man, that was cool. Bruh, I'm going to go buy that laundry detergent.
Here's the thing. China is 99% Chinese.
Yeah.
Like, there's not a lot of black people in China. You probably have, like, I would probably give them 98% just miscellaneous. But it's all Chinese for the most part. So they probably look at Jones and see no issues. Because, you know, why?
Do you think that America is a little more... For all our flaws, we are a little more accepting of everybody's rights and views because of the fact that we are so mixed up.
Yeah.
I think the problem is...
That's what the greatest parts about America.
I think the problem is a lot of the money and the political clout that is used to affect and change things is still wielded by the establishment, who are white men, you know? And I think that's why, you know, a lot of the big things happen. But I do think we are a little more accepting because of the fact that we are so diverse. You know, my son goes to school with, you know, Hispanic kids, Asian kids, Indian kids, you know, black children in his class. Yeah, maybe that's why we're so accepting. But, I mean, Jesus, man. I could not believe this commercial. You got to see this commercial. If you didn't see it, go on YouTube, racist Chinese detergent ad, type it in, look it up. It's crazy, man. All right? She could have just... And you know what the debate, the blame thing was? She could have just poured some detergent in after him, after she stuffed him in there. You got to stuff it in his mouth. You know what I mean? Like, what are you trying to say? Like, Jesus Christ.
I don't know if that's the most blatant part.
You couldn't, like, take his shirt off and put the shirt in there. You had to stuff the whole man into the washing machine.
How else are you going to turn him Asian?
I did not expect that Asian guy to pop out of that washing machine, man. Like, that was the funniest part of it. Why was he wearing lipstick? That was the funniest part of it. It was funny when she stuffed him in. The Asian guy was funny when he popped out. But after the commercial was over and you sat back and thought about it, you said, damn.
That shit was racist. Because, dude, racist when you first posted it in that group, chat with Steph, like, I looked at it, I was like, that's pretty funny. Steph was me like, that shit is racist. Yeah. I was like, yo, wait a minute. Racist, I think you're right. It took me a minute. Like, yo, it was I didn't funny. Catch on immediately.
Like, it wasn't funny when she was stuffing him into Washington.
It was. It was and funny. He was definitely all in. He was trying to hit that jump.
Oh, he was. Man. And you also think, like, what about the actor? You know? Is he getting any backlash for this?
He got paid for it.
I mean, he got paid for it, but people see his face all over that. How could you agree to be in a commercial like that? You know?
I don't think he cares. Or, you know, maybe he does care now. Mm-hmm. At the moment, he was probably looking for a check.
I mean, the backlash from his commercial, man. Nowadays, with the internet, you release a commercial for China, people in America are going to see it. You know? Yeah. So, you have to know those things. When you sign up to do a commercial, you have to know those things. I wonder if they told him how the commercial was going to be. Because after he comes up kind of swooning and all that, they could have shot the rest of that commercial after they told him to leave.
That's true.
You know? So I wonder if they told him. Yeah, who knows, man? It's China. Who knows?
Like, they recorded him come up with a white shirt. He was like, hey, my shirt's clean.
So they weren't. Nah, yo. They're not racist enough hire black people. They hired him for the commercial.
No, they're racist enough to hire a black person.
Well, I mean, you got to give him credit for that. They did hire the guy. He got what if they had
hired a person with Thailand? Like, they're brown. And then out pops a bleached white person.
That might have been a little better. You keep it Asian, you know?
You know what? Maybe you're right. That's another issue, but it didn't involve black people. I'm cool. I'm better with that.
That's wild, man. I could not believe that Asian guy popped out of that washing machine. I keep saying that, but your first initial thought when that guy popped out was, the fuck? And my first initial reaction was laugh, but then it was, the fuck? This guy really, like, she washed the nigga off? So, yeah, it was funny, man. Everybody I showed that commercial to starts laughing. And everybody always sits back and says, damn, that was fucked up.
Funny. Like, it was funny.
It was funny. The first initial thought is laughter, but it's...
Later, you're like, shit, Jesus,
did that just happen? You know what I mean?
Because you can't believe they would do that.
Can they do that? Like, is that legal?
You know what? That's us Americans being sheltered, dude.
Yeah, maybe we are. We're just sheltered. A little more sheltered than...
I'll be honest. You know what? That's what it is, you know?
I heard
they couldn't have made that shit in America.
When all this Obama stuff was going on, that... You know, black people have a tendency, I think it was a white guy making this video too, who I seen it, said black people in America can affect or create so much change just from our ability to band together in times of need. You know, like nobody, he was saying his opinion is no other group or race of people bands together so easily over a common cause than black American people. You know what I mean? Like, when we have a certain direction that we want to move in as a peoples, you know? I mean, look at people protesting for riots in Baltimore, in Ferguson, they're protesting up there in New York when a guy got killed by the police last year. Even President Obama's election. I mean, look how many black people were walking and supporting and being trying to be a part of that. And everybody's pushing in the same direction. So if we could band together and try to affect some of the changes in our own society, we could make so much change, man. You know, black dollars matter. You know, black dollars are just as green as white dollars, you know. And these business companies, the reason there's so much backlash whenever a racist ad or even a ad against women or anything comes out is because these corporations care about the bottom line, you know. And you start taking that money away from these people. That's when the change and the effects happen, you know? So, yeah, man, it's crazy, man. Yeah, I would love to see us all band together and push in a common direction, man.
That would be great, man. But I feel like, dude, like a lot of time and money has been spent pushing us in different directions.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah. It's a systematic thing. It's not just something that has just happened. They've been planning this for years and years. How do we destabilize this community?
Since we've been free. It's been about keeping the black people, the black populations,
and under your thumb,
segregated, under control.
We don't want you
moving
your
in the directions
money,
we
you
want
spend
them,
your money here.
Thinking the way we want them to.
Yeah,
and when we do go against the grain, that's when change happens. When we go against the planned out course for us, that's when change happens. But mm-hmm. until then, it's always this. The struggle is pulling all black people towards a single point. That's a great point.
It's a systematic thing, man. It's, you know, how do we destabilize these communities so that we don't have these kind of uprisings in the future, so that these guys don't organize themselves. They're not able to, you know, you take your father away from his son by locking him up or whatever. All of a sudden he's into the streets. He's selling drugs. He's, you know, trying to do this and that instead of being shown the proper way to be a man and how to organize himself and conduct himself in a manner that's positive for his himself and his people, you know? So it's a systematic thing, man. But this ad, man, Jesus Christ. I know one thing. I got to go buy some of this detergent. I know that. Where can I find this detergent at? I mean, geez, like, you know, I got to watch that, you know, seriously. Like, I couldn't read the name of it, but I want some.
I know some black people need to be white.
Jeez.
It'd probably be better
off. Yeah, man. Can we wash white people to black? Because we can do that. I mean, we can do that. We can do that to Hillary.
Turns out. Fucking Hillary black. We just ain't washed her right.
We got to just wash Hillary. She's good. Properly. You know?
Like, oh, shit. That's why she can do that.
Damn.
That's why.
You can wash Hillary. She can do the Harlem Shake. I know one thing, man. I got to get some of this laundry detergent. I don't even know what else to do. I don't want to use Tide anymore. I don't want to use Ultra. Okay. I can't go to the dollar store and get that brand anymore.
Genetic engineering.
I got to get some of this laundry detergent.
Genetic engineering in a pellet.
Like it was
in a laundry pellet.
Like they put a little splash of magic in this laundry detergent. You know, yeah, there's a little splash of sorcery in this thing. When I first sent you that article, you were like, what kind of witchcraft is this?
That joint made of stem cells.
I said, man, what kind of fuckery is going on in this commercial? You know what I mean?
And quantum energy.
Jesus.
Turn black people Asian.
Like, did he go through a portal when she...
Can that detergent turn black people to other things?
I don't know. Can we turn into superheroes? Like, if he'd have popped out, like, Captain America or something like that at the end of that joint, I'd have been like, damn.
No,
I
he
gotta
went,
get some of that
he went in as Falcon, came out as Captain America. Oh, shit.
Yes. Finally. Yeah, don't give us no bullshit-ass superhero. They give us a guy who could actually do something.
You want Captain America come out as Black Panther?
Yeah,
like, oh, shit.
Yo, that'd be cool, man.
All right, I'm cool.
I gotta
with that,
get some of this laundry detergent, man. Where can I find this stuff?
Get some of that shit.
If anybody who's listening to this knows where I can find any of this kind of laundry detergent, let me know. In transition, to touch on the pop culture side of this podcast, I know most of our topics tonight have been politically, religious, racial based,
charged.
My fellow co-host Juice sent me a Minecraft article. Article about Minecraft. I don't have the specifics about that article.
The article was in the Washington Post. It was written by Clive Thompson.
And the reason this topic jumped out to me was because I bought Minecraft for my son on the PS3. He watches a bunch of Minecraft videos on YouTube. My nieces, nephews, my stepson does. I mean, Minecraft really has literally captured a generation. You know what I mean? These kids love Minecraft for some reason. And I kind of understand it, but then again, I don't. Like, the graphics on it are kind of whack. I don't know if you ever played Minecraft, but they're just blocks. They're put together with blocks.
That's the greatest thing.
Robotically, you know what I mean? So
that's
it's like
the thing
no...
that amazes me the most is the graphics are literally big ass blocks.
Big
like
blocks.
We spent the last 25 years getting mm-hmm. away from high pixelated images. Mm-hmm. You know, well, PS3 and PS4, and now we got Xbox One. You know, like
and you come with this game, where the characters are literally blocks moving like stick
big
through
pixelated
the...
blocks.
Yeah. So why is it so popular? But the article said that Minecraft was released 7 years ago, mm-hmm. Obviously capturing a generation. There are 100 million registered players, because obviously you have a computerized version as well as your PlayStation and Xbox versions. average cost for the game is $27, and right now it sells 10,000 copies a day. And one of those 10,000 was me a couple of days ago, maybe months ago, because I bought it for my son. So,
and what was my nephew upstairs?
Man.
I didn't buy it.
I cannot believe it. First, my first thought is, if you invented Minecraft, which I don't have the gentleman's name, but
it was bought. Jordan Persons.
It was bought by Microsoft from him for $2.4 billion.
I think he's Danish.
That is ridiculous, man. You struck a gold mine when you invented this game. You know what I mean? Like, I'm sure he didn't know he was going to capture the hearts and minds of children and that
so here's
it was
going to
be so popular. The thing is that the average person who plays this is an adult. You know what I mean? You have a high percentage of women that play Minecraft. There's adult men. You can create your own online world. You can create your own online map. So you'll start a map online. You'll build up a world. You know, you'll put roller coasters, castles, whatever. And then people can come play on your map. You know what I mean? So it's just a great platform for creativity. And
this is like a hype dream. Like, this is a person who pursued his design of a game in his free time. So he was apparently, I think it was originally a programmer or a monitor on a website that managed photos, mm-hmm. like, you know, Flickr or something. He did something like that. And in his free time, he would create games. And this is just a game he created in his free time with blocks that blew up, and he sold it
to Microsoft. You never know where your golden egg comes from.
So, okay? Whatever you're doing, keep doing
it. I'm pretty sure this guy did not know this was going to be this phenomenon when he first started this thing, but he ended up having his idea bought from him for $2.4 billion. What the fuck? You know what I mean? Like, can I get a piece of that? This is the third best-selling game in video game history behind Tetris and Wii Sports. Which Tetris, wow. I can kind of understand, because Tetris
is similar.
It is similar,
for era, for that era,
who didn't play similar. Tetris? I mean, you have Tetris on your cell phone. I have it on my cell phone right now. You know?
There's something appeasing about putting blocks together.
Mm-hmm.
Like, yeah, this is a block game. It. Tetris is a block game.
Wii Sports, I was kind of surprised at. Maybe the Wii, when it first hit, it was so much different from PlayStation to Xbox.
It was the first, like,
attractive families.
Physical, yeah, action game.
That you could actually system, move and right? bowl and hit, you know, with the tennis racket with the remote. And
yeah.
It's a little bit different. But man, it's crazy, man. There was a point in the article that states Minecraft is digital construction and education. Industrialization and the mechanization of society has caused us to lose touch with physical skills, which Minecraft kind of promotes those physical skills. You know, you put this block here, you put that block there, they power another block to open a gate. You know what I mean? So it kind of teaches you technical skills as far as, you know. And one thing that's cool about the game, they also talked about in the article, is that there are no pop-ups when you start the game. When you start the game, you just have to start doing stuff. You know, you go hit a tree, you make wood. You gather the wood, now you have seven blocks of wood.
So it's literally out there in a terrain with no explanation.
You have to craft things. You have to craft a panel to make the block for your house. You know, so you make the block for your house, you have to go cut more wood. Now you need a door. You got to go cut more wood. Now you need a gate. You know, you have to go mine steel. You got to go mine redstone. You got to mine diamonds. So it doesn't tell you what to do. You just kind of have to figure it out as you go. And man, that's genius, man. Because
it's a complete open door for your creativity, especially for young kids. And I think that's why they look at these things as completely different. So, in the article, they mentioned a lot about the difference between Legos and building blocks, and how those were the structures children have used over time to help build their creativity. They would put them in open lots and have children just build, and how they're attracted to construction sites, because of the way construction sites have the leftover pieces, they're and then moving, they have at the same time they're still building new mm-hmm. heights, and this game really reflects that in a more functional and a more immersive digital way, you know.
And I don't get it, because the graphics are so cheesy. You know what I mean? Dude. Like, it's like they're literally blocks on top of blocks, walking and stacking more blocks.
That's the most fascinating thing to me. That's
why
the
is
most
it so popular?
Thing.
I don't get it. Guy who invented this went backwards in technology, made the graphics a little more cheesy and blockish, and it's a hit. People love it, you know.
But maybe that's why it's so good, because of those simple blocks. he had a wider range mm-hmm. of creativity. There was I guess.
Mold you had to fit into.
Right. Like, maybe because of their blocks, like, they can stack mm-hmm. things like that, you know? Yeah. They can build it. And maybe because there's no storyline, they can do whatever they want. They just know bad guys are coming eventually. Mm-hmm. Just
so you set have to up. Build up your shelter. You have to fortify yourself. You have to mine and craft a sword, you know? You have to get the materials for it. You gotta build your, you know, it's...
If you look at it in, like, a, in, like, anthropological, like, way, like, just monitoring human interaction and monitoring, like, how people deal with things, like, it's kind of fascinating mm-hmm. how kids are drawn to this, and they're in a situation where they can create. Yeah.
He's four. My son loves this game. Minecraft. He said he won a Minecraft birthday party next year. So, man, that stuff's expensive, cool. too, man. You look online for, like, a Minecraft table cover and a party banner. It was like $80 for that joint, man. Like,
man, it's blocks. Just
kids some paint. Love Minecraft. Yeah, can I make a Minecraft guy?
You can make your own. Yeah, dude. Easy.
Sticking with the Lego topic,
cardboard boxes.
The article stated that Minecraft has succeeded Lego as the respectable creative toy. Lego play is quiet and stimulating. It states that today's cultural observers say that Lego has moved away from open-ended engagement because it is so often sold in branded kits like the Hogwarts Castle or from Harry Potter or the TIE Fighter from Star Wars. So you don't have that creative open-endedness.
Yeah.
You buy a box and this is what I'm building. So I you let build me this move model. Towards this picture. Yes. Where Minecraft is, okay, you mine wood when you first start the game. Now where do you go? Man, maybe I need to build a house because I'm getting attacked at night, you know?
Yeah.
You build a house.
You build for functionality.
Exactly. As opposed to aesthetic. You need a weapon to defend yourself. Man, how do I get a weapon? I guess I got to go mine some stone, you know? Then you have to mine the iron, and it's Minecraft, you know? So you have to figure things out as they go, whereas Lego is just more of a streamline, you know? I want the TIE Fighter, so I see it on the box. I want the ship from Pirates of the Caribbean, so I see it on the box. I buy it, I build the ship from Pirates of the Caribbean. It's done. There's no creativity there. You know, yeah. You've already created what you want me to build, you know?
I personally fall victim to that. Like, I've definitely fallen into that before. Like, my nephew would get something, mm-hmm. like a little, like, rover or something, a little Lego. And he used to love Legos.
Mm-hmm.
And I would sit with him and build it with him. And I would be like, hey, we flip these directions and do it. And he'd be trying to do his own thing. But I'm like, hey.
No. That's not what the direction said. That block goes over here.
Yeah, that goes over here. And I'm like, and you know, he never thought about it. And mm-hmm. I'm like, oh, wait. Like, this is what Legos were originally for. And I remember when I was a kid, like, I didn't have Legos with manuals.
And also, Minecraft makes sense because it's in a digital
random pieces.
Video game medium, whereas Lego is... The only Lego games you see now are Lego Star Wars or Lego Marvel Super Heroes.
And it's not even building.
Which is actually fun. You play Lego Marvel Super Heroes?
Yeah, I played that.
I watched it with my son, man.
Yeah,
fun.
I played that joke.
It's a cool game.
I was
surprised there was so much to do in that little Lego game. I was like, man, it was kind of cool, you know? But, yeah, man, I mean, it's your creativity is only limited by your imagination in Minecraft. I mean, people have recreated the White House. I've seen people that have recreated King's Landing from Game of Thrones on Minecraft.
Word?
You got people that have recreated the Star Trek Enterprise on Minecraft. I mean, It's like you're only limited by your imagination. And I mean, that's just ingenious to me, man. I mean, whoever invented Minecraft is sitting back pretty right now, man.
Oh, he is.
The article said that they didn't even want to, they wanted to interview the guy for the article, but he declined the interview. Man, you got that much money? I don't even want to talk about Minecraft anymore.
So he said he was getting so much like pressure for like new upgrades and new. He was like, "Look, I didn't mean it to be all this, but fine, have it, but leave me out of it."
So I mean, $2.4 billion.
It's kind of like taking a life of its own. Like that's the amazing part. It's kind of taking a life of its own. It's flourishing, and people. And the cool part, mods. Mm-hmm. So people are modding new items to add to this immersive, huge world. And for like a game nerd, or even just a person, a kid getting into this, like that's amazing that they're already doing things like this after only, I guess 7 years is a long time, but still, yeah. It's a lot of depth. They're adding their own depth to it. They're creating, like you said, they're creating King's Landing.
Man. It really is just, I mean, go on YouTube,
that's some serious creativity. That's some
best Minecraft creations. I mean, they have castles. I mean, like people spend days and weeks building these things, you know. They were saying in an article that some people get mad because they'll do an update to the server, and all of a sudden their creation that they've been working on for, you know, a couple months, a roller coaster or anything like that, it doesn't work as well because when they did the update, they changed the way the mechanics work inside the game. Now that joint doesn't work, so they wasted 8 months working on this thing that doesn't work anymore due to this update, you know? Yeah. So, I mean, people take it seriously, man. I got a question, though. From the article, do you think that kids and children's impulse to tinker within Minecraft pushes them to master real-world technical skills?
I don't know. I don't think so.
I think the bottom line, when it comes down to it, it's still a video game. And children are... Their attention tends to be fleeting a little bit. Sometimes they'll pay attention to that, they'll pay attention to this. It's a video game. I don't know if they're looking at Minecraft and saying, man, I wonder if I put this redstone here, and I put a redstone there, and I put a steel block there, it transfers current to this door. I don't know if that's stimulating them enough to want to master...
Like electronics.
Be an electrician or something like that, you know what I mean? It's a video game. I think kids are looking at it to have fun.
I think there's a certain element to having fun and learning. Mm-hmm. So that's how... What was it? I forgot the person quoted. I don't know if it was Darwin. But anyway, somebody said that children learn... The way children learn is through playing. Mm-hmm. So that's the best way. And primary, the main way. That's why they're always playing. Because that's how they learn. And they're saying that through Minecraft, children can learn like constructs through of Boolean logic. Mm-hmm. Which is what programmers use, and computational thinking of how to set patterns in a certain way to have a final result. So maybe it's not like, oh, I put this block here or put this block there, but what they deal with is problem solving. Mm-hmm. They deal with, oh, this isn't working the way I wanted it to. Maybe if I change these things here, maybe it'll work this way. Like kind maybe it's just the elements of the... elements of the thinking patterns, as opposed to particular, like, you're not gonna be able to put a red block in real life and get a whatever happens with red blocks. I don't understand Minecraft. It's so strange.
I will say, me and my son and Michael, the castle we built on that joint is sick. Word. I ain't even gonna lie, dog. We've been doing that joint since when I get in that game. Christmas, man.
Y'all got the same. Oh, word.
Yo, I got towers. I got this big glass tower, like, monument joint. Like, you can set these, like...
I never actually played it.
You can put these blocks down, so it'll shoot, like, a beam of light into the sky. I got them joints in different colors all around the castle. We got underground tunnels to connect each part of the castle. Like, Mike built a big treehouse. So we got an underground tunnel that joint leads you out to the treehouse. We got an underground lab, you know what I mean? It's cool, man. It is pretty cool, but I don't... For me, it's cool in a limited capacity. I can't sit there and watch YouTube videos and play it for all day for 8 hours a day and build this huge, complex, mega structure that, you know, I play with my son for 2-3 hours. I'm like, okay, I'm done. You know,
yeah,
I'm going to play Call of Duty or NBA 2K or something. I'm done.
Yeah, but kids will sit there and watch the YouTube videos. I don't know if they're learning from those or if they're just watching it for motion and activity.
I don't know. Who knows, man? Because my son will watch a YouTube video of Minecraft, and then the next video he'll click on will be like an Easter egg where, like, they'll have, like, candy inside of a plastic Easter egg, and it'll be just a guy showing his hands. He'll have the Easter egg, like, whoa, let's see what this is. And they'll pop the egg open, and it'll be, like, Ben 10 or something like that. You know what I mean? And
he'll be like, whoa, my dog guys, be watching these people playing with dolls. Like, they just watch people playing with dolls. I'm like,
how is that interesting?
What is... You can do that.
Like, you know what I mean? I guess, man. I definitely thought that article was interesting when I seen it, because it definitely connected home, because my son plays it all day, man. Videos, everything, man. So,
look, maybe it'll make kids smarter.
I gotta buy some Minecraft stock. That's what I need to do, man. Does Minecraft have stock? Can I buy some of that?
Microsoft has.
Yeah. Let's do that.
Getting on that.
Yeah, man. Well, I think that's probably gonna take us out for this installment in the Intelligent Idea Talkers podcast.
Shit, this is a pretty good episode.
What is this, episode number 5?
Episode number 5.
5. Man.
Intelligent Idea Talkers.
That's what's up. Hopefully, this podcast will hit for us the way Minecraft hit for that guy who invented it. We can sell the rights to Intelligent Idea Talkers for $2.4 billion. And split it each $1.2 billion, you know what I mean?
You know what I'm saying? I'm with you.
I kick back, you know, somebody else do the podcast, man.
Intelligent Idea Talkers, we got more things coming up for you guys.
Twitter account is on the way.
Episode 6 coming up. Twitter account's on the way. We're working on a book kind of a concept where we're gonna go over some books we enjoy and discuss them with whoever's interested, you know.
And we got to discuss various the format ideas of that book idea, because I like that. I do like that, Joe, because I listen to audiobooks.
It's a work. It's a work in the process. So we love audiobooks.
Yeah, we'll discuss the way that's gonna go. But yeah, guys, thanks for listening. Appreciate all the support, if any.
I'm sure there's some.
Yeah.
Somewhere.
And I guess we'll be back next week for episode 6. Till then, I'm your host, D.
This is Juice.
Peace.